So we can take a long signal and turn it into a short pulse fairly easily, such as if we want to turn a steady, regular clock signal into a series of rising or falling pulses. But what if we want to go the other way and take a short pulse and turn it into a long signal? For example, for a predetermined amount of time. Like if you want to put a button that the user can press for a brief moment, and it causes a backlight on a screen to come on for a few seconds. Well, it's fairly easy, with a slightly different monostable multivibrator. And once again, this has to be done with CMOS logic gates, because just like before, having the base current through the BJT messes up the way the circuit works, so you need the CMOS, which basically has no gate current. So we start with our trigger signal, which I'll call T, and just like before, it's T0. We give it a steady high signal when we want it to be inactive, and we give it a brief low signal when we want it to be active. Now, to connect it to a button like I was describing, you would just use a pull-up resistor to make sure that the actual signal is always high, and then you connect the button directly through the ground to low, negative, which overrides the pull-up resistor. You know how that works. And because it's CMOS, it's not going to be any noticeable battery drain just sitting there with a pull-up resistor on the gate. So to do this, we need only a few small components. An inverter, a diode. Been a while since we used just a regular old diode, huh? A capacitor, a resistor, and one more inverter. The whole circuit connects straight through just like this, and this is your Q0. Once again, you're getting a high signal to say it's inactive, and it gives a low when it's active. And then these two are both in parallel, connected to your negative. You'll notice this is a straight end-to-end circuit. There's no feedback. And as a reminder, the CMOS, the input here is going to be drawing basically no power. The input here is going to be drawing basically no power. So these two components here are isolated within themselves. They're getting a connection to positive or negative through this inverter, and then they're connected to each other only through the negative, so they could pass through that way. So it is an RC network, because they are connected at the negative point, and of course, up there. So very simply, if you have a signal, so it's high, and then the user presses the button, and then lets go of the button, and, you know, don't worry about, you'd have your debouncing or whatever in there. But there's the signal the user gives. What this circuit does is normally it outputs high, and then when the user presses the button, it goes low. That's this point. The user lets go of the button, and then it stays on for a certain amount of time, and then goes back high. And of course, it'll be a slightly more curvy curve. It always is. This is a representation. This is the logic level. The previous one, the one that generates the pulses, when you give it a signal, it is going to give its output signal for a certain amount of time, no matter how long the input signal is. You hold that button down, it's going to give its pulse, and then it's just going to wait for you to let go of the button. This one is going to be active for the entire time you hold the button, and then it's going to be active for a fixed amount of time thereafter. So it's press button time plus RC network time. So it's a pulse extender or a timer, whichever way you want to look at it. And approximately, again, according to the reference I have, the duration is approximately 0.8 times R times C plus trigger, of course. So it's how long you hold it plus roughly this. Roughly, you'll have to calculate, you have to mess around with it to get the right number. But this is about what you're going to get. Your capacitance and resistance, because we're using CMOS, there's no gate current. Now, this is called a monostable because there's one stable state. When you let go of the button, it's going to stay in its unstable state for a certain amount of time, but it will wiggle back into the stable state. And it will always wiggle back into that stable state. But I like to think of this as a dual monostable, not a bistable, but a dual monostable. Because if you're holding the input low, then it is stable. It will stay output low for as long as you hold that. Unlike the first one, where you hold the input low, but eventually it goes back anyway. So I like to think of this as two different monostables in one, depending on input low or input high. But it's designed for a short pulse, pressing a button or whatever, so it's not really meaningful. The only meaningful monostable state is the one where the input is not active. So first let me describe to you that monostable state, and then I'll show you how we get around to it. So when everything is inactive, here let me not use blue, let's use green. When everything is inactive, your trigger here is high, because it's off, T0, your output is going to be high. So you've got a high going in here, into this inverter, so that means low, high on this side, low on the other. So you've got low going into this diode, And then over here on this side of the inverter, we've got high, which means low has to be over here, which means this resistor must not have a voltage drop. It's trying to get low through here. This is low here and low here. So if we have low going into this inverter, that means there's no voltage drop here because otherwise this would be high. So there must be no current going through here, which means the capacitor must be discharged. And we're getting a low on the top of the capacitor as well, which means low on this side of the diode, and everything makes sense. So the monostable state is when you're giving it a high, it's putting out a high, and the capacitor is discharged. So high inverts to low, your capacitor's discharged, so nothing's going through here. The diode's not conducting, but there's nothing to conduct anyway. The low is through here, and high out the output. Now remember, this is a CMOS gate, so we do not want a floating input. If this is not conducting, like this has got an active low, but this is not conducting, so there's not low going through this diode, there's nothing going through this diode. This diode has a floating output, but this is essentially a pull-down resistor. So when this has no voltage drop, it's just connected negative through, the diode is doing nothing, the capacitor is doing nothing. So this gate is getting an active low input, even though this diode has a floating output. So now, in order to activate this, we change the input to low. So we've got a low going into the diode, the first inverter, which switches the first inverter to a high output. So we're getting a high on this side of the diode. We're getting a low on this side of the diode, so now the diode is going to begin to conduct. When the diode begins to conduct, it lets through a high. Let me do this to indicate the diode is conducting, which means the capacitor is getting a high through here because current starts to flow. See, current is flowing and it's trying to flow into this inverter, into the capacitor, into the resistor, because we've got low on one side, high on the other. Here, I suppose that's a little confusing, so I'll just leave it off. The point is it's conducting. Got a high on the left, low on the right. So the capacitor has a high and a low, so the capacitor begins to charge that way. And since it's in parallel, the resistor also has flow going through it, which means it has a voltage drop, which means this goes high. Because there's current, there's a voltage drop across the resistor, and this goes high, which means it inverts it to low and the output goes low. So to recap, we switched the input to low, which this inverter brought to high, which because we had high on the left and low on the right, the diode began to conduct, which is charging the capacitor and the resistor in parallel. The capacitor is doing its own thing. The resistor has its own parallel current, not affected by the capacitor. They're in parallel now. They're not in series, they're in parallel. So the current over the resistor is causing a voltage drop, which is going from negative voltage drop back up to high, inverting to low. Now, eventually the capacitor is going to charge. So eventually it is going to stop. But the resistor is still going to have current through it. The capacitor is not going to stop the current through the resistor. The capacitor is charged, but it's in parallel. It's essentially in a decoupling capacitor arrangement here. It's charged up and ready to go, but it's just sitting there. But we've still got this current through this resistor, so we've still got high here. So the button is still being held, and it's just going to wait. So now we let go of the button. So the input goes back to high. So the inverter starts getting a high input, which means it puts out a low input, puts out a low output. So now we have this capacitor, and since there's a low, this resistor is no longer going to be conducting because there's no more power here, right? There's no more power coming through, so that resistor is no longer being fed by this inverter through the diode. So the diode is not conducting. The capacitor, however, was charged. The capacitor now begins to discharge. It's acting as a power source. The diode blocks it from going back through there because this is putting out a low, so if this diode wasn't here, it would discharge through the low output of this CMOS gate. But the diode prevents that. So now, essentially, this capacitor is putting out a high here. It's pushing back up this way. So there is still current, right? Current was coming from this way before. Now it's coming from this way. Can't go this way, so it has to go right. And it's going through the resistor still. Before it was being fed by the inverter, now it's being fed by the capacitor. So the resistor actually does still have current going across it, which means it still has a voltage drop, which means this is still high right here, because now the capacitor is generating the high. But eventually the capacitor is going to run out of power. It's going to provide so little that this gate is going to turn off. So this inverter is going to get a low, which means it's going to put out a high, and the output will be high. So then the capacitor fully discharges, the resistor stops conducting again, and everything's back where it started. And we've got our low back on this side of the diode. So this one is actually easier to operate than the other one. Remember, we had to have a clock signal that was enough to charge on the high side and discharge on the low side. This one, all you have to have is a low signal, the input trigger, long enough for this capacitor to charge. Once it charges, and it charges very quickly. See, this is technically a short circuit. And if you have a huge capacitor, if you have a high voltage, whatever, you might need to put a resistor in series with this capacitor to make sure that the capacitor doesn't overheat or it doesn't draw too much current, which would affect your timing. So you'd have to use series resistance to figure out the new RC timing. You'd basically take this resistor and split it, but you could do that. But for a very short pulse, reasonably low voltage, like 5 volts, small capacitor, it's not going to be a problem. It'll stop charging before it heats up appreciably, as long as this can put out the power. So as long as you have your input pulse long enough to charge this very quickly, not the RC time, since we've got this short-circuited, but just a brief pulse will charge this up, and then you can let it go. And then, obviously, you have to let it discharge before you do it again, but this is not, you wouldn't plug a clock into this. You wouldn't take a clock and lengthen it. That wouldn't make any sense at all. This is for timers, one shots, that sort of thing. So the discharge time is the function. It's not something you have to wait for. It is literally the function of it. But if you don't wait, if you press the button again too soon, all it's going to do is reset the timer, because all that's going to do is immediately set this back to low and start charging the capacitor again. So it doesn't cause the circuit to fail, it resets the timer. So if you keep mashing that button, you can just keep it on all the time, which may very well be what the user wants, so feature. So for the price of, since we're doing CMOS, for the price of 4 MOSFETs or 1 NAND chip or inverter chip, 1 diode, 1 capacitor, and 1 resistor, or maybe 2 if you need, you can have a nice timer circuit. Now, there are chips like the 555 timer that are multi-function timer chips, and they're incredibly cheap. Any device can afford one, but they are a little bigger. If you're using tiny surface mount components, you can probably fit this in a very small space. And in addition, to configure the 555 timer, you need other components anyway. You need resistors and whatnot to make the timer work right, because it's just a chip. It's not like you plug in a programmer and have it store its values. You have to use components to program it. So you're really not saving anything by trying to use that more advanced chip. You can just throw this in there and you're done. So next time, the last in my trilogy of multivibrators, for now at least, until then, I'll be seeing you.